All right. Well, good morning, church. Good morning to all, everybody who is here and joining us from wherever you are. We're excited and glad that you have joined us. So thanks for that opening song, guys. That was great. For myself, it sure feels good to be able to walk through the front doors of this building and to be here in person. I feel privileged to be able to do that. But keep in mind, the church is not confined to these walls. The church is wherever you guys are. So we're glad that you have joined us and are able to worship God from either here or your homes or wherever you may be. To all our regular attenders, we miss you. We miss your smiling faces as you walk through the doors. We miss your warm greetings. But hopefully soon we will be able to see you guys all again in person. Those of you who may be tuning in to us for the first time at Winkler Mennonite Church or are fairly new to us, we extend a special welcome to you. But we know you're out there, but we can't see you. So we'd still like to connect with you. If you do have access to the internet, so Winkler Mennonite Church website, you can download our bulletins. And on the back, you will find some information there, some emails, contact numbers, phone numbers. We want to hear from you. We want to connect with you. So welcome to our service. We're glad you all have joined us, and we trust that this service will be a blessing to you all. So with that, if you guys have your bulletins at home or have downloaded them, if you want to grab them, we're going to highlight a few announcements. Because of COVID, we have decided to postpone our annual general meeting. So we're hoping to do that in March. Typically that happens in February, so we'll see what March brings. The staff here at the church just want to remind you or let you know that on Tuesday morning, starting at 10 o'clock, they hold a staff meeting. So during that time, they're not available to either answer the phone or come to the door. So maybe make prior arrangements, but keep in mind that on Tuesday morning, starting at 10, the staff are involved in a staff meeting. The library is continuing with their curbside pickup on Tuesday mornings. So if you're interested in accessing the library, please contact Lorraine. And there's a call, there still remains a call for somebody to take leadership of the Monday night ladies' Bible study. So if you feel a tap on your shoulder there that maybe God's leading you to maybe step up and be a leader in that area, Danny Hildebrand would love to hear from you. And I got a thank you note here from Pastor Jeremy and Amanda, so I'll just read it here as he had written. Thank you very much to all those who have prayed for us, offered words of encouragement, and given us letters and gifts as we transition out of ministry at Winkler Mennonite Church. Thank you as well to all those who took the time to come to the farewell drive-through last Sunday evening. It's been an honor to serve you these last 4.5 years. You are loved. From Jeremy and Amanda. On the back of your bulletins, you're going to see a full-page highlight of this week's meeting from the transitional leadership team. So I encourage you to go there and read that for yourselves and see what these guys have been up to. I know they're working hard at propelling our church forward, so we thank them for their service. And here's just a bit of a highlight here of some of the things that they are dealing with. So with that, our call to worship this morning is found in Psalm 66, verses 1 to 4. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing praises of your name. Will you join me in prayer, please? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this opportunity we have to come together in worship. We know that your church is not confined to these walls of this church building, and so we thank you that we can experience you and worship you from wherever we are. What an awesome gift. We ask, Lord, that you be especially with Jeremy and Amanda as they continue to seek your guidance and direction for what you have in store for them next. And we thank you for their dedication, their work, and their love that they have shown to this church during their time here with us. We ask that you continue to lead this church and this congregation and that you provide direction for the transitional leadership team as they seek to propel this church forward. May they find joy within their role of serving, and may their work be a blessing for each one of them and for this church. We thank you for their willingness and desire to serve our church in this capacity. We pray that you will bring forth a willing heart to step up as a Sunday school superintendent. We know how very important it is that our children have the opportunity to learn and grow through this program. You know the gifts within your people, and we ask that you tap the shoulder of those you want to step up and fill these vacancies. We know it's difficult for us when we lose loved ones. It pulls on our heartstrings, and we rely on you for comfort, strength, and peace during those difficult times. We ask that you continue to be with Pete, Jolene, and Jack and Ruth and their families as they continue to grieve the loss of both Percy and Mary. Lord, we give you thanks for the many blessings that you continue to provide to us. It's a privilege for us to be able to give back, and we ask that you bless our tithes, our offerings, and our gifts, as well as those who graciously give. May you use these gifts to grow this church and further your kingdom. We thank you for those willing to serve and to take part in this morning's service. Be especially with Merlin as he shares his testimony with us this morning. Grant him courage and boldness as he speaks from his heart. Be with the worship team as they lead us in praise, and may the words that you have placed on Alden's heart this morning take a hold and fall on fertile ground. We commit this service to you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Scott. Good morning, church families, wherever you are. Welcome here. I invite you to join us sitting, standing, eating breakfast, whatever it is you're doing. Join us this morning in some songs, lifting up the, just praising our God and Father this morning.
I'd rather be his than have riches untold. wanna be close, close to your side. So heaven is real, death is a lie. I wanna hear voices, angels above, singing as one. Hallelujah.
As we've been doing through some Sundays in November as well as December, we've been hearing some testimonies from people who are on our new transitional leadership team. So this morning we will have Merlin Heppner come and share. I've appreciated Merlin being on our team. He is one who has a deep love for God and a great commitment to this church. Merlin, why don't you come?
Thank you, Aldon. I appreciate the introduction. Take the mask off and don't normally hold the mic, but I'll try it this time. Good morning. My name is Merlin Heppner. As probably most of you know, this is my testimony. It's part of the transition leadership team exercise that we're doing. I think there's only one left after me, so Wes will be the final one next week. Most of you will likely know me, or know of me at least, as I've been a worship chairman here at the Winkler Mennonite Church for a number of years, as well as being on various committees and church council prior to the move to the elder board. I was born here in Winkler in November 1971. I know my hairline makes it seem more like 51, but it was 71 that I was born, to John and Helen Heppner here in Winkler. I was raised in a loving Christian home. where church attendance and service were lived and modeled. I remember Mom and Dad being involved in church, Mom in Sunday school, and Dad with various positions. I accepted Jesus into my heart at an early age. We were faithful attenders of the Zummerfeld Church here in Winkler. I attended Sunday school and youth at the Zummerfeld Church and was really challenged by some good mentors there at the church, including the former pastor here, Gordon Reimer. In 1987, maybe even 1986, my parents, along with a number of current members, although that might be dwindling a little bit, but the people of this church who struggled with some of the rigidity of the Zummerfeld Church. The culture made it a little difficult, and they took the initiative and the bold step of faith to leave the only church that they had ever known and start a new church, the Winkler Mennonite Church. And that was started in 1988. I was 16 years old at the time. Being a lifelong church attender, I was excited for this new chapter. It was a little more hip, if you could say that. I don't know, disrespect to the previous church, but it was certainly a step in a more modern direction. And it was a good time. Everybody was pulling in the same direction. It was a really, really unique experience. But being a teenager, I had started a job a few years earlier, and a pull from some of those negative influences at work, coupled with the desire to follow God, conflicted me. So I love the attention of friends who were seeing the world through teenagers' eyes, being a little bit rebellious, and the desire to be and serve in a church where God was the head. I was never the real rebellious type, but I certainly did stray a bit from the teaching of my youth. It wasn't until I moved to Winnipeg to attend Red River and moved in with a couple guys I barely knew from Plum Coulee that I started to see how people could be young, energetic, finding their own path and still serve God all at the same time. These guys in their friendship circle, they helped set me on the right path. Church became a cool place once again, and I found my Christian walk once again. I was baptized in this church, well, not this church, the old building, but I was baptized in the old church, Winkler Mennonite Church building. After school, after Red River, I started working at Smitty's Restaurant, where a certain young lady caught my eye. We worked together for a while before I asked her out. Helena and I hit it off right away, and we dated a few years before we got married. We lived and worked here in Winkler. We kept attending this church. We faithfully attended our whole married life, serving as Sunday school teachers, helping out with youth. We started a clubs program with Brad and Tracy, and that was a good introduction into kind of the real serving of the church. Starting something from scratch, you kind of learn something new about yourself, something new about your friends. Brad and Tracy were kind of hounding us. We weren't really friends at the time, but they kept bugging us, and we finally agreed, relented, and it's been a lifelong friendship ever since. So it's amazing what you can do when you actually open your eyes and your heart to God. And Helena served on Ladies Fellowship and on serving groups. I've served on numerous committees and have helped chair Sunday morning services for a number of years. Our three kids have all attended this church, with our oldest two, my two girls, having been baptized here a few years ago. I can say safely that our commitment to the church has wavered somewhat in the past few years as our church has struggled a bit with its identity. Part of this being on this transition team is kind of a lot of self-reflection, figuring out what it is that you want from church, what is it that you're willing to give to church. And in kind of preparing these notes here, it really struck me, you know, each of us have our own stories, each of us have our own personal stories, our own personal connections. But I'd really, you know, as part of the worship team, but even beyond the transition team, even beyond that, I want us to look in the mirror and ask our spouses or our family, honestly, what do we want to get out of church? What do we want to get out of church? But also more importantly, what we're willing to put into church to make it what it is that we want. That's critical. It isn't just about coming here Sunday morning or once we're out of this digital age, this virtual age where we can come and gather together, but what are we willing to put in to make this church a place where God is glorified? We don't know what the church is going to look like when this is all said and done. We all have our ideas on what we'd like to see, but as my good friend Wes Harder has said, it's really something that we got to leave to God. What it's going to look like at the end, that's for God to determine and for us to accept. So, you know, I don't have a long, elaborate story to share, but it's my story. It's still being written. I hope it continues to include the Winkler Mennonite Church as we all work together. I have those in capital letters, so I'll stress it again, that we all work together. Can I get an amen, at least from the people here at home, maybe? You know, we want to bring God as the center of our worship. He's the point of our corporate worship when we walk through these doors. It can't be about what Merlin Heppner wants. Can't be about what Merlin Heppner wants to hear sung or what I want to hear up at the pulpit. That's really irrelevant. It's God that has to be the focus of it. So as part of the transition team, I would encourage you to all to reach out to us, share your thoughts on what church could and should look like. Really would like to hear that. I know Pastor Aldon has said many times he wishes he could be out in people's homes and listen to everybody and get to know them a little bit better. You know, I know a lot of you, and maybe a lot of you know me or feel you know me because you see me up here, but I just really want to stress, if we really want to know each other, we got to be able to open up ourselves to each other. We're doing that through the transition team. We're doing this exercise with the book Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire, and it's about prayer. And we have to really make sure that we delve deep into God's Word and pray and get His thoughts on things. So I really would encourage each of you. You know, it's hard in this virtual world to, you know, we don't have the personal connections that we would love to have. We don't have the handshakes, the hugs, the seeing each other every week. You might still be seeing most of us, but we're not seeing you. Reach out to us. Get our numbers. I work at Friesen Insurance. You can call me anytime. My partners have been really good about that. I know we encouraged Brad a lot when he was on the elder board, so thank the elder board for their commitment. The behind-the-scenes stuff of running everything, making sure everything works, it's challenging. There's a lot. It's draining. We need your prayer. We need your support. But as part of the transition team, I just encourage you to reach out to each of us. Don't just pick the people that you see all the time. You know, pick everybody. Make some phone calls. You know, stop by our places of work if it's possible, and share your thoughts. In closing, I'm just going to leave with you a Bible verse, or Bible passage, I should say. It's more than one verse. It's Matthew 22. 36 to 40, and it's sometimes called the Great Command, the Great Commandment. I think it's one of those ones that it really simplifies everything. You know, we can make things as complicated and complex as we want, but the reality is the greatest commandment is this. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? They asked. And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Simple. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So I think if we would stick to the simplest things, the great command, I think a lot of things kind of fall by the wayside. So, you know, as we all share our stories, you know, everybody here, everybody in the virtual world has their own stories. Share your stories and humble yourself a little bit. Make yourself a little bit vulnerable. That's when we're going to grow as a church. That's when we're going to grow and we're going to see God. Because God is in my heart. God is in Alden's heart. God's in Pastor Jeremy's heart, he's in Robert's heart, he's in all of our hearts. Whether we're up here, whether we're serving, whether we're playing the drums, or whether we're the PA operator, God's in our hearts, and he should be the focus of all that. Amen.
Well, we want to pray for you, Merlin. Thank you for sharing. And Lord, we just thank you for this time of hearing Merlin's story, just a bit of it. We pray your blessing upon him, his family, his wife. We pray that you would be lifted up in their home, at his place of work. I thank you for his love for the church and that you want to do great things through this church. So, Father, we pray that the whole team, the transitional team, the whole body, that we would sense your presence, and may you be lifted up as we go through some challenging times. Some of these decisions that we're part of are difficult. We pray for your wisdom, your grace. Help us to love one another exceptionally through these times, that you would be lifted up, and as we seek you, that we together would grow in grace and become the church that you want us to be. So we thank you for all that you want to do. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning, everyone. It's nice to be back and to see you this morning. Well, sort of see you. You can see me better than I can see you, but it's good to be here and to be worshiping together. I think that all of us very likely were very happy that December 31st came about and we could move into January 1st, because with COVID and all the challenges that came with learning about COVID last year, it's easy for many of us to become depressed and wonder, when will this be over? I'm sure there's many who are hoping that somehow magically or miraculously things will rebalance themselves in 2021. There's a lot of hope that the vaccine will be effective, that there'll be a stop to the spread and we can get our lives back to normal and be together on Sunday mornings. But what if, is it even possible that 2021, COVID could be worse than it was in 2020? We hope not. But as we've experienced this second wave in many places, it's even worse than what we first experienced last year. So on January 1st, I'm sure many of you were going, phew, we can turn a new leaf or go to a new chapter. 2020 is behind us. We can get on with something better. Well, here are some lessons and observations that I learned or that I observed, and I thought I'd just share them with you this morning as we begin. One of the things that came to mind or as I observed is, we've all come to know that life is more fragile than we assumed. We assumed that life was pretty good. We try to prepare for things. We have so many conveniences. But overall, we thought life was pretty good. How could a mindless virus shut down global travel? How could it overwhelm our medical system so easy and take away the freedoms that we had known? Another lesson is that the church gathered is far more valuable than we ever knew. Maybe if we reflect on it sufficiently, we recognize that we were spoiled when it came to church. We didn't know it until we had restrictions and there were limitations as to how many people could show up on a Sunday morning, or just the fact that we could even come to a worship service. We've missed coming together as believers. Many people who I've met have lamented that they miss the smiles, they miss the handshakes, the hugs. Okay, worshiping online is better than nothing. It's okay, but it's just not the same as being there in person. We've rediscovered the presence of God as best experienced in community. As Scott said, just coming through the doors of the church has new meaning. It's like, wow, it's good to be here. A precious and powerful reality happens as we gather in his name. One of the observances I make is that we've learned new practices, new words. Who had ever heard of social distancing before 2020? Or face masks were so valuable, or live stream, or Zoom calls, or preaching to a camera, or drive-through hot chocolate to facilitate fellowship and connection. 2 years ago, we would have frowned on these ideas as compromises to our faith. And yet today we're more like missionaries. We're taking risks. We're seeking God's guidance. We're learning to pivot and to pray. We ask for help like we haven't before. There's also a new hunger for God. Many people around us are asking, what does this mean? And we can say God's in control. These are crazy and uncertain times, and one of the most amazing ways to staying centered is through prayer. A story is told of a boy, 8, 9 years old, loved fun, even some mischief, often got himself into trouble with his best friend. And one day, the mother, out of frustration, decided to go take him to the local minister. They weren't church-going people, but she thought the minister might have answers. So he sat down in the pastor's office, and mother was there too, and pastor said, "Son, where's God?" The little boy was stumped and said, "Son, where is God?" He didn't know, and he was kind of finally raising his voice even louder. The minister said, "Son, I really want to know, where is God?" And the little boy got up and bolted out of there, and his friend was by the door of the church, and he says, "Let's get out of here. They've lost God, and they're blaming it on me." God is our amazing Father. The most amazing way to find God is through prayer. Yet, prayer is a struggle for most of us, maybe all of us. I love people who have discovered the value of prayer and often are called prayer warriors. But prayer is the most unnatural thing for independent, distracted, busy people, high-energy people, self-sufficient people. It's just not something we easily do. Today, we want to start a series on the Lord's Prayer. We're going to use Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13 as our text for the next few weeks. This morning, I just want to do a brief overview where Jesus offers a guide of how we should approach our Father. This prayer is known by many who may never even go near a church, or maybe it's a prayer they've heard or they've learned sometime in a younger stage in life. Yet, there's something very different about the Lord's Prayer than many of our prayers. Many of our prayers have a different tone than what Jesus taught. We tend to say something like, "Oh God, please forgive me and help me to stop sinning." Or a young husband might say, "I only have a 42-inch TV, Lord, and hockey season started, and Super Bowl's just around the corner. Can you help convince my wife that we need a 75-inch TV? Dear Jesus, please give me enough food so I can provide for my family. And Lord, be with our missionaries. Help James to get better, and be with Angie and Ben and Carolyn and David and Ian and all the others I love." That's often what our prayers sound like. And these are normal motivations. We often start our prayers asking for forgiveness, for wants, for food, for justice, for healing. But in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus invites us to come to the front door of the Father's house, directly to the front door for worship and fellowship with our Father. Don't go to the side door. Don't go to the back door. Don't go to the servant's entrance. Come to the front door. So I imagine a gatehouse, perhaps with a long driveway in this incredible mansion. You pull up. "Hi, Dad. It's me." The gate opens. He invites us to come. You drive in this beautiful manicured lawn which has fountains and nice pavement, and everything is clean and just. And you see the front door, and it just opens, and it greets you. And there is the Father, this big smile, and he says, "You are loved. You are loved, and come, I want to give you a hug." He warmly welcomes us. "I've been waiting for you." He can hardly wait to see us. But the truth if we were truly honest with ourselves, is that most of us would feel more comfortable coming to the side door because we don't feel worthy of this holy, awesome God. We really feel we don't qualify to come through the main gate into the front door. Friends of ours in Abbotsford who attended the same church as we did, they had married at a later stage in life and didn't have children, and they wanted to have a ministry presence, and so they built a very nice bed and breakfast, a ministry center, a spectacular home. They called it Sweet Dreams. You can Google it, and Sweet Dreams Abbotsford, and it's a beautiful, expensive B&B. They hosted many church events and Christian organizations and secular organizations, beautiful place. They could have several meeting rooms at one time. I'm sure they had at least 10,000 square feet floor area. And it was nice to be there. It was amazing coming through the front door. And as friends, we sometimes would come to their living quarters through the side door. I worked for the Mennonite Brethren Seminary for 9 years, and some of that included going to events in different places like Disney World in Orlando, or in 2005 we had meetings in Fort Worth, Texas, and some of my colleagues were bringing their spouses. Betty joined me, and we have friends we'd gotten to know that live in the greater Dallas area, and so a ministry colleague that I had met works for Dallas Theological Seminary. And when you're new to something, you always want to learn from the best. And I discovered through some of these meetings, she was the best. And I contacted her and I says, can I shadow you for a day and learn from you? And she was like, sure, okay. And so I called my friend Ray, who lived close to where she lived. And I says, hey, Ray, we're going to be in your area. You know, we'd like to visit. He says, in his deep voice, he says, Aldon, do you need a place to stay? You can stay at our house, you know. And so we arranged that we would stay there for 3 nights, and they had just built an $8 million home. We felt pretty unworthy to come to their house, and he was happy to have guests, and his wife, they were very welcoming, and we stayed these nights, and they have a big house right on the edge of Grapevine Lake, and it was amazing to be toured through this house, which had made the front page of House and Garden magazine and things like that. And they took us to church on Sunday morning. Of course, it's Texas. That's big too. They had about 30,000 people as part of their church. Everything's big in Texas. But just thinking about this, remembering that experience in 2005, I want you to imagine with me coming to a driveway, a long driveway. You were driving our beater. The invitation says, come to the front door. So you come down this beautiful entrance and you drive and you feel unworthy to go to the front door. Rather, you see there's a side entrance. Maybe that's the kitchen. You peek inside, you step cautiously, you look around. Food's been prepared. There's the aroma is a great meal, and the sight of the food alone in the kitchen as you come through that side door makes you hungry, and you find your way through the kitchen to the dining area. And the invitation said, come to the front door, but you felt so unworthy. You felt so you didn't belong, and the table is set. You realize again you've come in the back way, and you continue to explore this house and the flow of this amazing home. And there's so much detail, the high ceilings, the round stairway, and all those things that ooze with affluence. Now you're getting a better idea of the flow of the house. And there you find the front door, and the Father is looking out, waiting for you, and you've come in through the side door. And he's puzzled. He says, the invitation said, come to the front door. Why'd you come to the back? But he's so glad to see you. The meal's ready. Come and sit down. Come and eat with me. What holds us back from praying? What holds us back from seeking God and coming to the front door as he invites? often some of the things that hold us back are what we call unanswered prayer, where we've prayed and prayed, and it just seems that God keeps being silent. We haven't had the answer we wanted to the prayers we've offered, and we're perhaps not convinced that prayer really makes that difference. So why bother praying? I'll just worry instead. What about our unoffered prayers? Usually our unoffered prayers are because of pride. We don't pray, I'll call them unoffered prayers, because there can be a religious pride. Yes, we acknowledge Jesus, but we live independently. Such people often are the ones who gladly attend church, but they live as if they don't need God. There's a second form. First form is a religious pride. Second form is there's an anger at God form of pride. We've been disappointed with God. We have prayed, we've asked. He's answered differently than we wanted. And there's a big hurt and an anger towards God because he didn't come through for us the way we wanted. And pride can be the biggest prayer killer, because proud people don't ask for any help from anyone. Often our many comforts. Because of our many comforts, we don't have what we would call this world needs. And we easily become distracted by the things of this world, and we forget the importance of prayer. But Jesus said, come to the front door. Matthew 6, 9 to 13. I'm going to read this from the English Standard Version. Pray then like this, Jesus said, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. The King of the universe, our Father, waits at the front door of heaven. He says, welcome. It's this incredible invitation to a personal relationship with the God of the universe. But why do we easily gravitate to the back door or the side door? Because we easily feel unworthy. The entire biblical story from Genesis to Jesus and the final restoration of all creation in Revelation chapter 21 is all about God wanting and longing to be in relationship with us. He wants to share his life-giving energy with us, and that we open our lives to him in prayer. So I want to quickly highlight five things about the Lord's Prayer as an introduction this morning. First of all, we declare, our Father in heaven, we honor your holy name. God, you're so amazing, you're so all-sufficient, you are holy. With a correct starting point, it's easy to come to the front door. Our intimacy increases. He's holy, he's personal, he's relational. He always has time for me. In Luke chapter 15, where Jesus tells the story of the lost son and the father's great love, the son had messed up. He had disrespected his father. He had disrespected his family. He lived foolishly. But the father is there waiting, waiting and watching, ready to welcome. We're all prodigals at heart. Some with many sins, some with only a few. We all have this lostness about us, this prone to wander in need of so much grace. As a prodigal, we reach for the handle at that front door. And as we reach, before we even touch the handle, the door opens wide. Secondly, we petition, your kingdom come, your will be done as it is in earth, in heaven as it is in earth. Give us this day our daily bread. We invite him to be our king. in each area of our lives. He invites us to keep asking, come again and again, keep asking, not like the unjust judge in Luke chapter 18 who didn't care, and this woman who was experiencing an injustice, she just wouldn't give up, and she shows up and she's in his face, and finally, just to get rid of her, he's, okay, give her what she wants. God is not like that. Jesus says, God is not like that. In comparison to this unjust judge who just wanted to get her out of his face, keep praying. Keep asking. As long as we have breath, please pray, ask. Your will be done. We ask for healing. We ask for grace. A friend of mine, a pastor in the Vancouver area, some years ago when his wife was very ill with cancer, and he and his family were praying for healing, he would say, as long as I have breath, as long as she has breath, we will continue to pray for miracle. And if God chooses to answer differently than we hope, then we will pray and ask for grace so we can suffer well. That's a mature, God-honoring answer. Thirdly, we confess and forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. I'm sorry. Seek forgiveness wherever possible. Be quick to forgive. Be quick to extend forgiveness to others. If this is hard, find someone to console with, to confide in, and say, would you pray with me so I can address this? Ask for help through this difficult journey. Fourthly, we ask and we engage. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. We ask that he would lead us away from temptation. Too often we walk right into it, and the battle is strong and it's difficult. Oh, that you would lead us away from temptation so we don't have to deal with the evil one. One of the best ways to be in constant relationship with God is our personal devotions. Some of you are morning people. I don't understand night owls. Of course, when you're a morning person, the best part of the day is early in the morning. I love mornings. 6 a.m., that's a good time. For some who are night owls, that doesn't make sense. You learn to read, to meditate, and I say, find a time that works for you, but find a time where we can be alone with God. And so often when we do that, we find a scripture that helps and that speaks into that exact situation. Be in the Word. Find a time that works for you. If you're a morning person, find that alone time where it's you and God. Maybe it's a special chair. It's a special place in the house. The same is true if you're a night owl. Find a time that works for you, where we can wait on him. We can listen and we can enjoy him. Don't say to your spouse, you have to do what I do, but be consistent as much as you can. You know, the model of personal devotions is often referenced in Psalm 42. As the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul, my heart longs for you. That's the idea of regular, consistent time alone with the Lord. And if you're like me, that can be a struggle to find that time, especially when you live a crazy lifestyle, it's good to get a Bible app. And I have one that reminds me every day and helps keep me on task. I don't want to be legalistic about it, but I think just the other day I looked and I had 780-some consistent days. I go, yes. But then I have to be careful that that doesn't become a legalistic. God's going to not like you if you miss one day. Don't ask yourself, am I good with God because I missed today? The devil will do anything to discourage us, to give up. But I'm going to say next, we'll set some of you free. God loves camels as much as he loves deer. Deer long for the water brooks every day. And that's great, and I encourage all of us. But what if in your life, your lifestyle, and it's crazy like mine can be sometimes, you function more like a camel? See, sometimes camels take this long drink and they can go for days. I thank the Lord for camels. Sometimes I'm a camel, but I prefer being a deer. I can go for days and enjoy His grace and His presence. But whichever way works for you, God loves us either way. If we are deer or camels, just do it. Live in the grace and find a way that works for you. Sometimes He'll speak directly to you through His Word. Sometimes through the Holy Spirit, and His comforting Spirit speaks into our hearts. And sometimes He shows up and gives us a picture or an image or an impression, and His answer is very clear. And you just know because you know because you know. He guides us to see situations through new spiritual lenses. He meets us in that moment and sometimes, but not always, gives us an answer to the why. There's something about us human beings, we need to know why, and sometimes it just drives us crazy when God doesn't give us that exact answer to why. Fifthly, lastly, we also worship. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. This prayer ends the way it started, at the front door of heaven. He's given us a tour. We've sat at His table. We've been comforted and blessed. We leave refreshed. There's been confession. There's been engagement, and there's been worship. In closing, prayer is the most unnatural. The most unnatural practice for independent, distracted, busy, high-energy, self-sufficient people. We just struggle with doing it. Our circumstances may not have changed when we've prayed, but we're changed. We come uncertain, even distracted, we leave in peace. He loves us. He's for us. We matter to Him. We have 8 grandchildren. The older ones are young adults. One will be turning 20 in April. The youngest will be turning 5 in March. And when the younger ones come, they come into our living room. We don't have a big house, so our living room is child-friendly, and they spread the toys out over the floor, and they play hard, and they argue sometimes, and they play well together. And then when it's time to go home, there's a disagreement over who should clean up the toys, because suddenly the participants are very tired. You know what I say often? Come again. Come soon. You're loved. As we leave God's presence, He says to us, come again. Come soon. Come as you are. You're greatly loved. Lord, thank you for the way Jesus laid out a simple but a powerful way to pray, to come to you, to experience you, to experience your presence. And sometimes it doesn't change anything except you've changed us. We invite your presence in our midst, that you would be lifted up and we would be touched and blessed and changed. Thank you for inviting us to come to the front door. Amen.
Thank you.
and 25. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. And as we close the service, don't forget, turn to someone in your home, make a phone call, send a text, remind them you are loved. Enjoy your day.